You're listening to Psych with Mike. For more episodes or to connect with the show with comments, ideas, or to be a guest, go to www.psychwithmike.com. Follow the show on Twitter at Psych with Mike or like the Facebook page at Psych with Mike. Now,
welcome to the Psych with Mike Library. This is Dr. Michael Mahan, and I am here, as always, with Mr. Brett Newcomb.
Happy to be here.
How are you today?
Great.
So, we live in St. Louis, Missouri, USA,
yeah.
Which we tell people because we make allusions to things that are going on in our lives, which nobody
could know. Nobody cares about it, exactly.
Yeah. But today, we actually have a winter storm forecast. We've seen some other winter storms happening in the U.S. already this year, but we're under an advisory today, and we're likely going to get some snow, and that made me... So then what happened was the timing of this, we normally record on Friday mornings, and the timing of this is going to be later in the afternoon on Friday going into Saturday, and so my wife said... After you get done podcasting today,
get that man out of the house and get him home.
Go to the store because I'm afraid we won't. So then I said, yes, ma'am, I will absolutely do that. Then my daughter called and said, the store shelves are empty.
Ah.
We can't find anything. And then that actually was a news article in the news last evening, is that the store shelves are empty. And then that made me think about, what is it about snow days? What the F?
F is in snowfall?
Yes.
Yeah.
That's right. What I mean, why what is the psychology behind snow? Because I actually sent you more articles on the snow thing than anything else, because the articles were fairly superficial. So I'm not sure that there is a psychology of snow days. But what I know is, so let's assume, so some of the articles talked about that.
Well, like so many other things, there are a couple of elementary data points.
Yeah.
And then there are miles and miles and miles of interpretation.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. But one of the things that was fairly consistent was this idea of powerlessness, that it's good to not have control over things. You don't have
That's
control
what my
over
father
snow
used
days.
To say to me, it's good for you to feel powerless.
Yeah.
I want you to feel that on a regular basis.
But then I was thinking, but we don't feel the same way about snow days as we do about other kinds of acts of God.
Well, seldom, if ever, are you going to have people that have a really good playtime in the middle of a flood.
Mm-hmm.
You might have somebody out in a kayak running around saying, look at me, aren't I wonderful, I'm in this fast-flowing stream. But snow days, people go out and play in the snow, if mm-hmm. they have them. They see them as an interruption of a schedule. I got a day off from work, I got a day off from school, and I got a new environment to play in without going anywhere.
So I guess, is the difference between that and some other natural occurrences that are out of our control?
I'm really having fun in this earthquake.
I was going to say, is the damage, so there's more damage both in terms of lives lost and property
yeah.
in other forms of natural disasters that don't happen, and not that a snow day is natural disaster.
They are, by definition, disasters.
Gotcha.
And snowstorms can be a disaster.
Mm-hmm.
There are, one of the reasons you pay attention, like, week 10 days ago, they had I-95 and around the Washington, D.C. area was shut down for over 24 hours because they couldn't
clear the roads. No, I know, because, and so I teach both at Webster, Washington yeah. University, and also at Southern New Hampshire University, and that's online exclusively. And I had literally my entire class saying, oh, well, you know about the snowstorm, right?
Yeah.
So that was a big deal.
And you said to them, don't you know I live in paradise and we don't have those?
I said, oh, yes, of course I know. And
of course, the paradigm that the weathermen use for weather in Missouri is, if you don't like the weather here, wait 10 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So what do you, just knee-jerk reaction, because you're a person who has studied psychology and has done therapy for all of your adult life, just your own knee-jerk kind of reaction. What is it about a snow day that is so fascinating to us?
I think there's some cultural learning. As a kid, if I had a snow day, it meant I had a day off. I didn't have to go to school. I didn't have to turn in my book report. I didn't have to take a test, whatever. As a teacher in school, as a young teacher, I was very excited because I had a day off. I didn't have to get up and get dressed and go to work, and I didn't have to drive the roads. I didn't have to take the risk of having a car accident. I didn't have to deal with stuff. I could just be home, cuddle up, read a book, spend my day. As a more mature teacher, I realized that's a lost day of production. That's a lost day of consumption. You got to figure out how to modify and blend your assignments, and it's more work.
So what's the difference?
Old man, it's like you can't go out and shovel that snow. You're going to have a heart attack. You got to be careful. You can't drive on the roads because you're not a good driver.
Right.
So it changes. Our perception changes based on our reality.
So then what you're saying is that at least the high part of the snow day is the unexpectedness of it. It just kind of gets dropped in.
Which can be positive. Like I can have a day,
right.
You know, like staying in bed reading a book if that's how I want to spend my time.
And then that's different. Like we're recording this on a Friday. That's the Friday before Martin Luther King Day, which is a national holiday.
Right.
So then
5-day weekend. Let's leave town before the snowstorm hits.
Well, but so what's different about the snow day and Martin Luther King Day? You're going to be off school both days.
So what's a surprise?
It is the surprise of it.
And there's the ambivalence. It may come.
Mm-hmm.
I remember getting up.
Yeah.
When I was a school teacher, we had a snow chain, which is the phone chain that notifies you, hey, school's canceled. Don't get, because some of us live 20, 30, 40 miles away.
I found out listening to KMOX in the mornings.
We did too for a long time.
Yeah.
And then when the administrators figured out, we use our phones.
Yeah.
Let people know if they chose to. But then what we found out is superintendents all call each other.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the school district superintendent in this county calls one in the next county. Well, I'm going to cancel. Are you going to cancel? There are a lot of decisions that need to be made that are complex and involved. But as a teacher, I'd wake up in a heavy snowstorm forecast overnight. Wake up at midnight, look out the window.
Yeah.
Wake up at 1 o'clock,
sure.
And look out the window.
Right.
Wake
right.
up at 2 o'clock, see snow, and be like, "Yeah, great." And then wake up at 3 o'clock, the phone hadn't rung. Wake up at 4 o'clock, the phone hadn't rung. So you're powerless. You're experiencing the outcome of somebody else's decision, including the weather. So that's different than being the responsible person who has to make the decision.
Mm-hmm.
If I call, I've got all these people that normally send their kids to school who are going to go to work, who aren't going to have a snow day. But if I call school off, somebody's going to miss work, or they have to cover for the kids. The kids may be in jeopardy or at risk. I've got the state that says you have to be in class so many days a year within this calendar window, or we won't pay you.
Mm-hmm.
So if I don't, if I call a snow day, will I lose money from my school district? So it's a heavy, heavy burden to make the right decision, and you can't win.
Mm-hmm.
You can't make the right decision for enough people enough times.
Mm-hmm. So,
I'll lose you in all those details.
No. I'm trying to think about how I want to phrase this. So, part of it is that it's out of our control.
Yeah.
Part of it is the surprise of it.
And the adventure, the positive adventure.
Okay.
Let's go throw snowballs.
Yeah.
Snow angels.
And
look outside where it's beautiful.
Okay. So maybe the temporariness of the snow, because the snow's only going to last for a short period of time, so maybe that has a component in it.
Well, but some, I don't know. I'm a curmudgeon. I look at it and I think, crap, my car's going to get dirty.
Yeah.
My windows are going to get dirty. I'm going to have to shovel. It's going to be a burden. The place is going to be nasty. The only time I like snow, the only time I appreciate snow, is if I'm on top of a high mountain with skis on my feet trying to go down the hill.
Mm-hmm.
I like snow then. It's the only time I like it. Otherwise, it's interruptive. It's inconvenient. It's uncomfortable.
So, as
but
a
beautiful.
So, as a rule, as an adult, right now in your life, snow doesn't have the same fascination or appeal that it did when you were a child.
No.
Yeah. So there's also.
But
that.
I don't get out and go sledding. Well, I don't go to a hill somewhere and get on a sled with a kid or a dog and be stupid.
Mm-hmm.
I'm stupid in other ways.
But not in the snow.
Hopefully.
Yeah. So to break that down, do you find then that this idea, the fascination that we have as a society, maybe even as a world, with snow days, is that a good thing or a bad thing?
Well, I think...
Does it matter?
Well, I think we're looking at this from a very limited perspective.
Okay.
The Midwest perspective, where snow is a somewhat rare occasion.
Yeah.
If you grew up in northern Michigan, where it snows and there's snow on the ground for months and you don't see the grass, when we go up to northern Michigan, we have people, the locals talk to us about living an outdoor life. You know, I have a snowmobile instead of a motorcycle. I go hunting in the woods. I'm prepared and equipped for this. And I find, because the winters are so long and cold and uncomfortable, I find ways to have outdoor activities that mm-hmm. are enjoyable. Mm-hmm. So for me, living my little random life here in Missouri, if I get a snow day, I don't have all this stuff.
Right.
I don't have a snowmobile. I don't have a snowblower. I don't have, you know, whatever, to play with it or to work in the midst of it.
So do you think that they...
They adapt. It becomes normalized.
Do they have snow days there?
I don't think so.
Yeah, so the kids go to school no matter what.
Well, and the communities have the right equipment to make that possible.
Yeah.
Where you live, the school districts around here don't all have good snow removal equipment in their communities.
Right.
And it's a very hilly area.
Right.
And so putting those kids on a school bus, when the roads are slick or when there's snow on the ground and it impacts it, puts them at risk in ways that you don't...
But you, that is all about equipment and experience.
Yeah,
because
and necessity. It's not physically responsible for this community to buy that stuff.
Yeah, exactly, because they wouldn't use it often enough.
Remember when John Kennedy was inaugurated president? Are you old enough to remember that?
I don't remember him getting inaugurated. I was born
a snowstorm in
a couple of months
D.C.
after he got
and
assassinated.
And they were supposed to have this parade. Uh-huh. I don't want to hear it.
Okay.
They used blowtorches to melt the snow.
You had actually asked me the question, though. So I
know, but I didn't want to hear the answer.
Okay, all right. Okay,
you know me long enough to know that
I knew you didn't want to.
Don't want to hear the answer. Yeah.
But you and I have both spent enough time in the mountain passes in Colorado to know that in Dillon and Frisco, those kids are going to school no matter what. And we've
and
been
I
there.
I laugh my butt off as I go down the slope. I figure good for them because it keeps them off the mountain if they go to school.
Exactly. Well, sure, sure. But that's the whole point is that those kids go to school because in Colorado they have the equipment and the experience.
Yeah.
And they have switchbacks and roads that are very dangerous.
Yeah.
But those school buses go because that's their life and that's different than here.
I've driven some of those switchbacks behind school buses.
Yes.
And be grateful that they're there.
Mm-hmm.
Because they have these metal poles that stick up out of the snowbank to show you where the edge of the cliff is.
Yeah. Which is nice. Yeah.
It's helpful.
Yeah. All right, let's go to our break.
If you have a school bus full of kids in front of you, they'll show you where the cliff is.
Yes, they will.
Just don't follow too close.
And we'll be right back.
All right.
You know, if you've gotten this far into the show, then obviously you find the show to be worthwhile, beneficial, maybe even helpful. And so I just wanted to say, if you've gotten this far into the show and you want to help us out, even if you don't want to help us out, just do it anyway. Go to Apple Podcasts and rate us and leave a review. That is super helpful. Subscribe to the show on YouTube and hit the bell icon so that you get notifications when new shows drop. That stuff is really, really helpful for us. And I know that Mr. Brett agrees.
Absolutely. Reviews are positive. Positive reviews are more positive, but negative ones are as well, because it helps you decide how to focus and how whatever you're attending to say is being heard.
And the secret is the algorithm doesn't care whether the review's positive or negative.
As our friend Mike Norton says regularly, feedback is a gift.
If it's Friday, it's Psych with Mike. Okay, we're back. So do you think that the psychology that we're talking about that's involved with a snow day, is that like a real thing? So I guess what I'm saying is it just that we have have we created the psychology of snow day?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. So it's not something that's inherent in, so Neanderthals didn't look at snow and be fascinated or think, oh, this is great.
They had to worry about how is this going to affect my ability to heat my home and feed my family.
Right. And now all the berries are covered and it might be easier because I can see the animal tracks, but you know, it's harder for me to move through the, to move through the snow. So that's actually making me a less effective hunter.
Yeah.
So there's nothing, I guess this is what I'm really trying, the point I'm trying to make. There's nothing intrinsically or inherently in the DNA of a human being that says, oh, wow, snow is a fascinating thing.
You can't say that. I mean,
okay.
So you ask an Eskimo that, and then you ask somebody that lives on the equator. It depends on their environment. It depends on their opportunity. It depends on their culture.
Right, but I'm saying there's no universal.
Oh, okay, I'll hear that.
Yeah, yeah, there's no universal thing that makes us be fascinated with snow. And so the and our experience in the United States...
One of the things about human beings that is endlessly fascinating is their adaptability.
Yeah.
They can adapt to different environments. They can adapt to different circumstances. If it becomes normalized, you have to adapt to it. If it becomes situational, you have to survive it. That's not an adaptation. That's just, I got to get through this storm. I got to clean my driveway. I've got to get food for my family. It means if I have to put on snow boots and walk to the store, I have to walk to the store. But it's a momentary situation. It's not months-long winter. Mm-hmm. We're not living in the mountains of Colorado in 1856 with 20 feet of snow on the roof of the cabin and no store for 100 miles or 1,000 miles. Those guys had to learn how to survive. It's not, for most of us, it's not a survival issue now.
Gotcha. And that would, yes, I see. That would make it, that's a completely different context within which to experience
it. We can laugh it off. We can have fun with it.
Yeah.
We can be exuberant. We can take our kids out and let them slide down the hill.
Yeah. So if I'm living in, you know, Nevada in 1850 or whatever, and literally there isn't a store and I get snowed into my cabin and it's difficult to keep the cabin warm because all I got is a, you know, a wood burning stove. Yeah, that's a very different experience than living in the Midwest and they call a snow day and kids just want to go outside and build snowmen.
Truckee in the Donner Pass got over 20 feet of snow last week.
Yeah.
20 feet of snow last week. Today, you can go to the store in Truckee. You can drive through the Donner Pass. The Donner Party ended up doing cannibalism to survive. In that exact location.
Right. And we're stuck there for months.
Yeah.
Not being able to move. And you're saying within a week, you can go anywhere you want to go.
Absolutely.
Because the road's clear.
And if you had the right equipment, you could go then.
Yeah.
On a snowmobile or in a snowcat, four-wheel drive. You make adaptations.
So, but even still, we do live in a world where there is some fascination with this meteorological phenomenon.
Oh, yeah.
And for the people who... So I guess what I'm wondering is, should you force your kids to do homework on a snow day?
I don't know.
Yeah. See, that's what... That's kind of the whole...
Are they going to be under adult supervision?
Well, this is...
Or are you going to leave it for them to do?
Well, this is my... This, in the end, was the question that I was wrestling with when I decided, oh, I want to do a show on this, is should we just accept that it's a snow day, it's okay for everybody to take the day off, let the kids be kids, you know, they can eat sugary cereal, they
can... You can't make a universal decision about it. It's all situational. You know, I... 9 days out of 10, 99 days out of 100, take the day off, no harm, no foul. One day out of 10, it could be a problem. You have to calculate whether or not it's a problem.
Gotcha. So we shouldn't encourage people to just see the snow day as an act of God beyond which we have no control. Let everybody just have the day off. You have to take into consideration the circumstances. And I know that you obviously do, because you can't not eat.
But Michael, you try to create these formularies. This is what we should do. This is how it ought to be. Life is to be lived. People are going to do what they do. And as a therapist, you talk to them about how well is that working for you.
Yeah. Well, but I'm also struggling as a person, you know, trying to wrap my heads around these things. So, yeah, I do try and create these formularies because for me...
Should I be having fun?
Yeah.
Well, are you having fun?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Because for me, that feels more secure.
Should I shovel the driveway? Are you going anywhere?
Right. Yeah. So, in the end, what you're saying is that everything... is about that cost benefit equation,
and
you have to do the economics to be able to formulate a conclusion. Yeah,
as we used to teach in therapy classes, therapists have to learn and understand every behavior is in service of the self.
Mm-hmm.
So how are you serving yourself today?
Mm-hmm.
Well or ill?
Yeah. Okay, so this was kind of at least for me, off my head, kind of a topic, but I hope that was helpful for people. I think that there's actually some good information there that has benefited me, so I hope it was helpful for other people. If you want to get a hold of us and give us some ideas for shows, please contact us through MikeMahan.org. I'm not MikeMahan.org. PsychWithMike.com. You can contact us through MikeMahan.org. It can be done.
You can drop a letter in the mail. It can be done.
Absolutely. And we would love to hear from people. We are getting some good feedback about the show from more people, and we love that. That's fantastic. We really are encouraging people to go to iTunes and to YouTube and subscribe to the show there and leave a comment if you would like. That would be really beneficial for us. The music that appears in PsychWithMike.com is written and performed by Mr. Benjamin DeClue. And if it's Friday, it's Psych with Mike.